My name is Sneha Jay and I'll be the MC for today's event Olirum. First of all, I appreciate all the participants for joining our online event organized by the Rotary Club of Women's Christian College. This event is conducted on the account of Lung Cancer Day, which was on 1st of August. As we already know, lung cancer occurs in people who smoke. Now let's know more about it through this webinar. Now let's begin the event with the invocation song by Angel and Ritu.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. And here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Thank you, Angelin. Now, without further delay, let me introduce the speaker of the day, Professor Dr. Usha Ishwaran, a motivational speaker, entrepreneur, and a women's rights activist. She is a professional with over 30 years of experience in the fields of education and industry. She is now the planning board member in Thiruvallur University. Over past few years, she has conducted numerous training programs and seminars. She has addressed over 30 lakh people on the various platforms. She is a recipient of International Global Award 2020. She has over 1,200 videos in her YouTube channel on career guidance, motivational message, and much more. She is passionate in supporting social causes and assists numerous NGOs in the state. She is also the Pink Ambassador for NGO Chennai Turns Pink, promoting awareness on breast cancer and women-centric issues. I'm very happy to welcome you, ma'am. Over to ma'am.
Thank you so much. And a very good afternoon to all of you. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Are you able to see the screen?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so a very, very warm welcome to you all. And extremely happy to see the students of WCC Rotary Club. You know, you're conducting this Olirum program and especially concentrating to know a lot about lung cancer. This is a very good initiative. And I'm extremely happy to be part of this event. And let me share some information about lung cancer. It is an awareness creation initiative. So this is about me. I'm Professor Dr. Usha Ishwaran. I'm an engineer basically. So why an engineer is here to talk about cancer? I feel I'm also eligible to speak about it because my thesis, my doctorate work is on cancer detection. Actually, I designed an automated disease detection and drug delivery system for prostate cancer and ovarian cancer. So I feel so happy to be part of this, and also I do a lot of awareness campaigns for cancer awareness. And I was a lone speaker in a medical conference in China. I was invited there to talk about the system which I have developed in my research, so that the medical conference people will know how this engineering automation can be embedded with the medical knowledge what they have, and I feel so proud about going there and speaking in the medical conference. And basically, I'm a motivational speaker, women's rights activist, entrepreneur, educationist, career analyst, parenting coach, leadership coach, public speaking coach, human behavior expert, transformational facilitator, NLP master practitioner, emotional intelligence practitioner, and professional certified life skill coach. I have over 30 years of experience and addressed more than 30 lakhs of people and trained over 1 lakh students and placed more than 10,000 students and counseled more than 10 lakh people. And I'm a proud ambassador of India Turns Pink. And we have an initiative in creating awareness. This is the 6th year we are doing in our Namma Chennai Airport. In October, the entire month, we are going to have programs for creation of awareness for breast cancer. And I feel every one of us should take part in this awareness campaign, because cancer is a very, very a dreadful disease where we don't come across or we don't identify it in the early stage. So many people are suffering, and we are losing many people because of this ignorance, because they do not know the correct procedure to identify the symptoms. So that is the reason we are doing this campaign. And I'm very happy to be part of your session here, where I'm going to talk about the lung cancer. So we're going to understand about lung cancer. And here you can see today what causes cancer. We'll talk about what is cancer actually, and also types of cancer, cancer stages, and what is lung cancer, main types of lung cancer, common risk factors for lung cancer, risk of cigarette smoking, signs and symptoms of lung cancer, tests for lung cancer stages, and can lung cancer be prevented? So this is what I have for you today. And it need not be that we have those habits or we are exposed to something which I am going to mention today. Whoever is there in your relation or in your known community, known people, friends, relatives, whomever you see, you know, you can spread this message. So you are going to be an ambassador of spreading this awareness message to all, so that everybody will be taking care of themselves and prevent themselves from this cancer. So let us enter into this session. Let me first tell you what is cancer. See, the cancer is nothing but an uncontrolled growth of abnormal cells in the body. Because it is in the body, we will not be able to know what is happening, how it multiplies. And cancer develops when the body's normal control mechanism stops working. So that is what we call it as immunity, and something which can fight against all those abnormal cells growth. And old cells do not die. Actually, the old cells are supposed to die. But instead, what happens, they grow out of control. They will be forming new abnormal cells, and these extra cells may form a mass of tissue called a tumor. So that is what we call it as cancer. So we are all, you are all made up of trillions of cells that over your lifetime normally grow and divide as required. When cells are abnormal or when they get old, they usually die, and they should die. Cancer starts when something goes wrong in this process. What happens? The old cells don't die and something wrong happens. So that is where the cancer enters. And your cells keep making new cells, and the old or abnormal ones won't die when they should die. So what happens because of that, as the cancer cells grow out of control, they can crowd out normal cells. This makes it hard for your body to work the way it should. So that is how the cancer cells are formed. So what does the cancer cells form? Cancer is a disease caused when cells divide uncontrollably and spread into surrounding tissues. And what causes cancer? This is very, very important. The cancer is caused by the changes to the DNA. See, this is the one and only point which you have to first of all register in your mind. You are born with some DNA pattern, but it is changed because of some reasons, maybe because of your habits, because of some places where you expose yourself, and so many reasons which I'm going to tell you. So when it happens that the DNA itself is changed, cancer is caused. So most cancer-causing DNA changes occur in sections of DNA called genes. These changes are also called as genetic changes. And a DNA change can cause genes involved in normal cell growth to become oncogenes. What is oncogenes? Unlike normal genes, the oncogenes cannot be turned off. Remember this. This cannot be turned off, so they cause an uncontrollable cell growth. And in normal cells, the tumor suppressor genes prevent cancer by slowing or stopping cell growth. So in normal cells, there will be something called as tumor suppressor. When the DNA changes, that inactivate tumor suppressor genes can lead to uncontrolled cell growth and cancer. So now you can understand that normally when we are born with some DNA pattern, and later due to some exposure or some habits, what happens? It changes. And because of that, the suppressor, the tumor suppressor, because if that is active, it will not allow any abnormal growth. So that becomes inactive. So that is the reason we have this uncontrolled cell growth and cancer. And within a tumor, cancer cells are surrounded by a variety of immune cells, fibroblasts, molecules, and blood vessels, and what is known as the tumor microenvironment. The cancer cells can change the microenvironment, which in turn can affect how cancer grows and spreads. Immune system cells can detect and attack the cancer cells, but some cancer cells can avoid detection or thwart an attack. Some cancer treatments can help the immune system better detect and kill the cancer cells. That is why people go for a lot of treatments. And how do genetic changes affect the cancer treatment? Each person's cancer has a unique combination of genetic changes. Specific genetic changes may make a person's cancer more or less likely to respond to certain treatments, but some will not respond. Genetic changes that cause cancer can be inherited or arise from certain environmental exposures. That is what I said. So suppose if you have some hereditary, some history, so that may follow, that may continue in your pattern. But apart from that, there, it will also be caused due to the environmental exposures. So we are responsible for that. So genetic changes can also happen because of the errors that occurs at the cells divide. So cancer cells develop because of multiple changes in their genes. And these changes can have many possible causes. The lifestyle habits, genes you get from your parents, and being exposed to cancer-causing agents that is existing in the environment, everything can play a role. But we are not aware of anything. We just do everything without even being cautious about what is around us, where we are, what are we eating, what is our lifestyle, what is that we are living our life as. People think getting money is what is life. No, living a healthy life is what is more happy living rather than getting money and having property and having power. So you need to be happy. You need to have proper lifestyle, which will lead to a happy, healthy life. Because we are bringing all those things into our body. And most often when we talk about the age, cancer-causing genetic changes accumulate slowly as a person ages, leading to a higher risk of cancer later in life. But nowadays, you can even see people, youngsters, getting cancer. You know why? One reason may be hereditary. The other one is habit, lifestyle, eating style, exercise problem. All those things lead to cancer even at younger stages now. And one more very important thing here is, what is metastasis? This is very, very important. The cancer cells can break away from the original tumor and travel through the blood or lymph system to distant locations in the body, where they exit the vessels to form additional tumors. This is called metastasis. So this is the reason people have some tumor and cancer, they go for treatment and they don't continue going for screening. So suddenly a person who starts having the breast cancer after going for a treatment, suddenly they may have a tongue cancer, they may have a throat cancer or a lung cancer or any other cancer, because this cancer cells would have transported there. It would have transported from one place to the other. This is what is happening everywhere when people don't go for regular screening. And in metastasis, cancer cells break away from where they first formed, the primary cancer, the first time where the cancer has come, and travel through the blood or lymph system and form new tumors. They are called as metastatic tumors in other parts of the body. The metastatic tumor is the same type of cancer as the primary tumor. If it starts with breast cancer, even if it transports to lung, it will be called as a breast cancer only. And if it starts at lung and if it gets transported to some other place, the primary tumor is what is the actual one. Then cancer is more than just one disease. There are two main categories of cancer. One is related to the blood, other one is for the heart. Blood, what are all the different types? Hematologic cancers, they are called as blood cancer, and they are the cancers of the blood cells, including leukemia, lymphoma, and multiple myeloma. Then the second, solid tumor cancers. These are the two main categories. One is blood, other one is solid tumor cancers. Here only our lung cancer comes. The solid tumor cancers are cancers of any of the other body organs or tissue. And the most common solid tumors are the breast cancers, prostate cancers, lung cancers, and colorectal cancers. There are many, many types of cancers. And this is what happens. And what is a tumor? A tumor is a lump or growth. Some lumps are cancer, but many are not. Lumps that are not cancer are called benign, and lumps that are cancer are called malignant. What makes cancer different is that it can spread to other parts of the body. While benign tumors do not go, and the cancer cells can break away from the site where the cancer started, and these cells can travel to other parts of the body, as I told you earlier, and end up in the lymph nodes or other body parts or the organs, causing problems with the normal functions. And we have several stages. This is very, very important. When a cancer is found, tests are done to see how big the cancer is and whether it has spread from where it has started. So this is what the first thing people do. And this is called the cancer stage. The lower stage, such as stage 1 and stage 2, means that the cancer has not spread very much. A higher number, that is stage 3 and stage 4, means it has spread more. And stage 4 is the highest stage. And the stage of cancer is very, very important in choosing the best treatment for a person. And now coming to our lung cancer. So lung cancer is a type of cancer that starts in the lungs. Your lungs are two spongy organs in your chest that take in oxygen when you inhale and release carbon dioxide when you exhale. Lung cancer is the leading cause of cancer deaths worldwide. See, many cancer, people get many different cancers, but death happens mostly because of the lung cancer only. And as I am going to tell you about this function, very important, because what we inhale is very important. What sort of air goes inside your lung is very, very important. Your lungs are two sponge-like organs in your chest, and your right lung has three sections called lobes. Your left lung has two lobes. The left lung is smaller because the heart takes up more room on that side of the body. When you breathe in, air enters through your mouth or nose and goes into your lungs through the trachea, which is nothing but a windpipe. This is your trachea. The trachea again divides into tubes called bronchi, which enter the lungs and divide into smaller bronchi. These divide to form smaller branches called bronchioles. And at the end of the bronchiole, I have shown you here separately the bronchiole. At the end of the bronchioles are the tiny air sacs. See here, the tiny air sacs known as alveoli. The alveoli, what it does is, that is the one which absorbs oxygen into your blood from the inhaled air and remove carbon dioxide from the blood when you exhale. See, the inhaling and exhaling happens without our knowledge. It keeps happening. So we are not knowing what it's actually doing, isn't it? So we are generally not really bothered about what sort of place we are, which ambience we are in, what sort of air goes into our body or into our lungs. We don't take much care of it. So that is the main problem. And lung cancers typically start in the cells lining the bronchi and parts of the lungs such as bronchioles or alveoli. So here only it starts. A thin lining layer called pleura. See here, pleural space. Pleura surrounds the lungs. The pleura protects your lungs and helps them slide back and forth against the chest wall as they expand and contract during breathing. Below the lungs, a thin dome-shaped, see here, this is the dome-shaped diaphragm, separates the chest from the abdomen. When you breathe, the diaphragm moves up and down, forcing air in and out of the lungs. So this is what is the anatomy of the respiratory system, showing the trachea and both lungs and their lobes and airways. Lymph nodes and the diaphragm is also shown here. And the oxygen is inhaled through the lungs and passes through the thin membranes of alveoli. See here, the alveoli is here. This is where the lung cancer starts. Now, I will tell you about the two main types of lung cancer. About two main things. One is non-small cell lung cancer. Other one is small cell lung cancer. About 80% to 85% of lung cancers are non-small cell lung cancer. And the main subtypes of non-small cell lung cancers are adenocarcinoma, squamous cell carcinoma and large cell carcinoma. These subtypes which start from different types of lung cells are grouped together as non-small cell lung cancer. The first one, adenocarcinoma, they start in these cells that would normally secrete substances such as mucus. This type of lung cancer occurs mainly in people who currently smoke or formerly smoked, but it is also most common type of lung cancer seen in people who don't smoke also. Why I am telling this is, it is more common in women than in men. NSCLC, non-small cell lung cancer, comes for people who smoke currently and who were smoking earlier, and even people who don't smoke, and especially women get more. And it is more likely to occur in younger people than the other types of lung cancer. Adenocarcinoma is usually found in the outer parts of the lung and is more likely to be found before it is spread. Next is squamous cell carcinoma. They are flat cells that line the inside of the airways in the lungs. They are often linked to a history of smoking and tend to be found in the central part of the lungs, near the main airway, that is bronchus. And next one is large cell carcinoma. The large cell carcinoma appear in any part of the lung. It tends to grow and spread quickly, which can make it very, very harder to treat. A subtype of large cell carcinoma known as large cell neuroendocrine carcinoma is a fast growing cancer and is very similar to small cell lung cancer. Because small cell lung cancer, about 10% to 15% of all the lung cancers are small cell lung cancers only. And it is sometimes also called as Oat cell cancer. And this type of lung cancer tends to grow, spread faster and faster. About 70% of the people with this small cell lung cancer will have cancer that has already spread at the time before they are diagnosed. It spreads so fast. Since this cancer also grows quickly, it tends to respond well to chemotherapy and radiation therapy. Unfortunately, for most people, the cancer will return again on some point of the time in their life. So now let us see the common risk factors of lung cancer. Actually, the non-smoking related risk factors we will see first. Because we are all thinking that only people who smoke will have the lung cancer. It is not true. There are people who don't smoke also get this. So they include the occupational exposure to asbestos, you know, people working and sitting and working in the asbestos sheets, chromium, arsenic, cadmium, silica, and nickel, as well as another most important is secondhand smoke and outdoor air pollutants, previous lung diseases, radon exposure, and the dietary factors. These are all the risk factors which are non-smoking risk factors. This is very, very important. Diet. How many of you take care of your diet? How many of us eat carcinogenic food items? Directly we take inside our body. And how many of us use our lotions, shampoo, oils, all the cosmetics? Did you check any time that you have any carcinogenic products there in your products which you use? Because they enter into the skin pores, which will make or cause cancer. So a lot of things we are ignorant. We don't give importance to all those things. We just say, I don't smoke. No one smokes in our house. So how will I get a cancer? So I'm now telling you the four sources where non-smoking people get. These are all different histories or the risk factors. But people who smoke has the greatest risk of lung cancer. If you know anybody, whoever is smoking in your family or in your friend circle, if you care for them, kindly go and tell them it is going to affect them in a bigger way. They may lose their life. And the risk of lung cancer increases with the length of time and the number of cigarettes they smoke. And if you quit smoking, if someone quits smoking, even after smoking for many years, you can significantly reduce your chances of developing lung cancer. So if somebody is having as a chain smoker, tell them to stop immediately or slowly as per their convenience and take advice from doctor, because this is definitely going to create problem in the future. So you can see what the cigarette is made of. See all those chemicals in that. Acetone, naphthalamine, methanol. Methanol is used as a rocket fuel, and pyrene, naphthalene, that is nothing but a moth repellent. Nicotine, used as a herbicide and insecticide. To kill insects, they use this nicotine. And cadmium, used in batteries. Carbon monoxide, found in exhaust fumes. Vinyl chloride, used in plastic materials. Cyanhydric acid was used in a gas chambers. Ammoniac, it is a detergent. Urethane, toluene, industrial solvent. Arsenic is a lethal poison. And dibenzocridine and polonium-210, it's a radioactive element. And DDT is an insecticide. See here. Smoking is by far the leading risk factor for lung cancer. About 80% of lung cancer deaths are thought to result from smoking. And this number is probably even higher for small cell lung cancer. So it is very rare for someone who has never smoked also to get small cell lung cancer. And the risk of lung cancer for people who smoke is many times higher than for people who don't smoke. And the longer you smoke and the more packets you smoke, the greater will be the risk. So that has to be spread outside. And also how this smoking causes lung cancer. They may ask you, you please note this slide and tell them, doctors believe smoking causes lung cancer by damaging the cells that line the lungs. The cells that line the lungs. When you inhale cigarette smoke, which is full of cancer-causing substances, that is what we call it as a carcinogens. Changes in the lung tissue begin almost immediately. At first, your body may be able to repair this damage, but with each repeated exposure, normal cells that line your lungs are increasingly damaged. Over time, the damage causes cells to act abnormally, and eventually cancer may develop. So you have to tell that. And another very important thing which I'm going to show you is how the DNA damaging effects of cigarette smoking mapped for the first time. People have mapped how the DNA is changing. So everyone knows that the smoking is bad for your health. The carcinogens found in tobacco smoke are even known to damage DNA itself. That will result in disease such as lung cancer. And now for the first time, scientists have created a method for effectively mapping DNA damage, allowing for better understanding of how smoking-induced cancers originate and why some people are more vulnerable or resistant than others. So please, my dear students, whoever is listening, if you know people who are smoking, give them this insight. And you can see it does not even give one cancer. It gives cancer in head or neck, lung, leukemia, stomach, kidney, pancreas, colon, bladder, cervix. All these cancers will come because of smoking. And other chronic diseases like stroke, blindness, gum infection, aortic rupture, heart disease, pneumonia, hardening of the arteries, chronic lung disease and asthma, reduced fertility and hip fracture. So all these things are because of the smoke. And this one we have to know. We are maybe non-smokers, but second-hand smokers. We are second-hand smokers. If you don't smoke, breathing in the smoke of others, when somebody is smoking in the train or in the bus or in a restaurant or wherever nearby, if they smoke, we are inhaling that. You have the risk of developing lung cancer. Second-hand smoke is thought to cause more than 7,000 deaths from lung cancer each year. See how dangerous it is? And exposure to radon gas. It is not only the cigarettes, but also radon gas. Radon, what is radon? Radon is naturally occurring radioactive gas that results from the breakdown of uranium in soil and rocks. You can't see, you can't taste, or you can't smell it. Radon is the second leading cause of lung cancer in this country and is the leading cause among the people who don't smoke. You people may go to some other state, some other city for job, or you may get married and you may get shifted. So you need to check whether that place is safe, whether there any radon gas is getting emitted or not. You have to check how much radon gas gets emitted in each and every place. And radon is a radioactive, invisible, unscented, and flavorless noble chemical gas with a symbol RN and an atomic number 86. That is formed in the Earth's crust. It is formed in the Earth's crust naturally. and it is released in the atmosphere and forms part of the air that we breathe. So it is in the Earth's crust and it releases, mixes with the air, and we breathe that air. Because of its imperceptible characteristics, radon in homes is a grim source of indoor air pollution. We keep all the doors closed. That is the biggest problem, which can be a silent killer in our midst. Thus, maintaining low radon concentrations in our homes and workplaces is very, very important. The pressure inside our homes is lower, and the air from the high pressure areas like those in the soil move to the lower pressure area like a suction, thus allow radon and other gas to enter into the living space through cracks and gaps. You may ask how it enters. You may have cracks in your walls and gaps in your windows or in your doors. It enters into that and again it can't go out. It circulates and we inhale that. So when these gases are confined inside the houses, it accumulates in dangerous concentration levels. Similarly, the radon gas also accumulates in buildings for workplaces. You also should check if you are going and working in some office. Suppose your office is in the basement, that will have low areas also will have problems of radon gases. The classrooms and other business, especially in the low areas like basements and scuttle area. Because of the differences in atmospheric pressure and densities, the radon gases pass in cracks, the building's foundation. It comes through the foundation or through hot water tank, sink, or even shower in the toilets. So radon can also build up in the top floors. It is not only in the basement. It will also develop in the top floors in the building because of the lack of proper ventilation. So you have to check for all those things. And zero levels of radon is ideal. But can we get that? That is impossible. We cannot achieve 0% radon. So the outdoors. People wanted to see when you buy an apartment, you finish everything inside the home. You don't even open the door. But if it is an individual house, you know, you go and sit in the lawn, you keep the doors open, windows open, you know, you just imagine how your ancestors' houses were. So you allow the fresh air to come in. Whereas in our apartments, that too, when we are using ACs and all, we don't even open the windows. So that is very, very risky. And you have to think about all those things. And that will cause the risk of lung cancer even if you don't smoke. So radon gas is the primary cause of lung cancer for people who don't smoke. And the symptoms of long-term radon exposure starts with coughing and crockiness and breathlessness and shortness of breath, blood coughing, chest aches, loss of appetite and lung infection. So regularly some people will have lung infection. So that is because of the air they inhale. So as a radioactive material, exposure to high concentration of radon will lead to cancer as the cell's DNA blueprint will be damaged. So you have to be really, really careful about it. So what do we do at home? You need to ventilate. You need to open the windows and open the doors, and you can have the exhaust running for some time so that it will allow the air which is inside the house to go out. So increase the indoor pressure. How do you increase the indoor pressure? Increasing air pressure indoors will push away the radon gases entering the space. So this can be done by installing exhaust fans as well as using combusting equipment such as fireplaces. Next, coming to exposure of asbestos. So people who work with asbestos, because they are cheap, many people will be having that, but that's highly dangerous, which will cause lung cancer. So lung cancer risk is much greater in workers exposed to asbestos who also smoke. It is not clear how much low level or short term exposure to asbestos might cause, but it will cause. Next, coming to exposure to other cancer-causing agents in the workplace, they are nothing but the radioactive ores such as uranium, inhaled chemicals such as arsenic, beryllium, cadmium, silica, vinyl chloride, nickel, compounds, chromium compounds, coal products, mustard gas, and chloromethyl ethers. These are all some of the chemicals which are carcinogenic, and also diesel exhaust. See here, the diesel exhaust. And arsenic in drinking water. So some places will have this arsenic in the drinking water, which will cause cancer. And the risk factors you cannot change. What can we not change? Previous radiation therapy to the lungs. People who have had radiation therapy to the chest for other cancers are at high risk for lung cancer, particularly if they smoke. And examples include people who have been treated for Hodgkin disease, or women who get chest radiation after a mastectomy for breast cancer. So this type of radiation will have problems. And pollution, the air pollution. Now that we are wearing the mask, I think the three-layered mask should be able to protect us not only from COVID, but also from this pollution. And in cities, air pollution appears to raise the risk of lung cancer slightly. And this risk is far less than risk caused by the smoking. But some researchers estimate that worldwide, about 5% of all the deaths from lung cancer may be due to outdoor air pollution. And some may be due to hereditary family history of lung cancer. And factors with uncertain or unproven effects of lung cancer risk is, one is marijuana smoking. You have seen this in movies. Lot of serials and movies have brought this. This marijuana, this smoke contains tar, and many of same cancer-causing substances that are in tobacco smoke. Marijuana cigarettes are typically smoked all the way to the end. Till the last, they will smoke, where the tar content is highest. And marijuana is inhaled very deeply. They inhale very deeply, and the smoke is held in the lungs for the longer time, which gives any cancer-causing substances more opportunity to deposit in the lungs. So because marijuana is still illegal in many places, it may not be possible to control what other substances it may contain. But still, if you see, if you happen to know someone, try to indicate. Then e-cigarettes, a type of electronic nicotine delivery system, and they do not contain any tobacco, but the Food and Drug Administration classifies them as tobacco products. So e-cigarettes are fairly new, and more research is needed actually, but still. Then next material is talc. Talc is a mineral that is in its natural form may contain asbestos. Some studies have suggested that talc miners and people who operate talc mills might have a higher risk of lung cancer and other respiratory diseases because of their exposure to this. And talcum powder, we all use talcum powder, is made from talc, but people have not done any research and told that it is going to cause cancer. So far that has not come. And signs and symptoms of lung cancer. So here you can see that in its early stages, lung cancer does not typically have symptoms you can see or feel. So let us see what are all the different symptoms you get. You may get this finger clubbing. Some lung tumors make hormone-like chemicals. One of them pushes more blood and fluid to the tissues in your fingertips. So they look thicker or larger than usual. Then tummy troubles. One or more than more people, you know, they when they have this cancer, they develop high calcium levels and a condition called hypercalcemia. Too much of calcium in your blood can give belly aches and make you queasy or constipated. You may feel constipated. You may not feel like eating, or you will not be thirsty. Another hormone-like substances that some tumors make will mess with your kidneys, causing nausea and cramps also. And some may have mental health issues also and will have back and shoulder pain. A pan-coast tumor. That is a type of lung cancer that grows in the upper part of your lung and spreads to your ribs. So because of that, you will get this pains. And then fatigue, a low red blood cell count or anemia is very common effect of lung cancer. anemia can make you really tired because your body tissues aren't getting enough oxygen. And generally speaking, cancer cells like to feed off the nutrients you need to power through a day. So when you have the disease, you may feel like you're dragging. Yes, anyone?
No, ma'am.
And being off balance. So this also happens. You will feel giddy and feeling off balance. And definitely there will be weight change. Some people with small cell lung cancer get this syndrome, and the cancer may tell your body to make a hormone called ACTH, which raises the level of cortisol. And this leads to fluid retention and weight gain. So on the other hand, hypercalcemia, a hormone problem that affects your kidneys, tend to make you lose your appetite. So you may stop to drop pounds also without trying. You will not be trying to lose weight, but you will be losing weight. So that also may happen. And then next problem, you will have eye problem. You will have to see, you may see some men with swollen breasts. It's a rare for lung cancer to be the cause of this. And sometimes it happens, a swelling in the breast. And headaches, a tumor in the right place can squeeze your superior vena cava, narrowing it so it's harder for blood to get through there. So you will have headaches and heart problems. Both hypercalcemia and anemia can cause symptoms such as a fast or irregular heartbeat. If your heart issues are from hypercalcemia, chances are it's severe and you could have a heart attack or go in coma. Severe anemia can also cause chest pains and shortness of breath. Then puffy face, neck or arms, this also happens. And weakness and achiness and blood clots. You will have blood clots. So these are all several symptoms. And different tests are there for lung cancer. Physical examination. So an exam of the body to check the general signs of health, including checking for signs of diseases such as lumps. By checking, you can find the lumps or anything else that seems unusual. So history of the patient will also be asked. Then comes the laboratory test. In the laboratory test, medical procedures that test samples of tissue, blood, urine, or other substances in the body. They do the tests. And these tests will help to diagnose disease, plan and check treatment, or monitor the disease over time. And also chest X-ray will be taken. Sometimes CT scan will be taken. And then the sputum cytology, this is also do. A microscope is used to check for cancer cells in the sputum. And if lung cancer is suspected, a biopsy is done. You know what is a biopsy? So this is a fine needle aspiration, that is FNA, biopsy of the lung. So here a removal of tissue of fluid or fluid from the lung using a thin needle. So then they will take it for the experimentation. Then endoscopic ultrasound, this is another test. This is a type of ultrasound that may be used to gauge the FNA biopsy of the lung. Then comes the bronchoscopy. Bronchoscopy is a procedure to look inside the trachea and large airways in the lung for abnormal areas. So through that, they will be checking. Then mediastinoscopy. This is another test. So this is a surgical procedure to look at the organs, tissues, and the lymph nodes between the lungs for abnormal areas. They see the abnormal areas. So after the lung cancer has been diagnosed, tests are done to find out if the cancer is spread within the lungs or to the other parts of the body. A lot of imaging tests to look for lung cancer, to look at suspicious area that might be cancerous, to learn how far cancer might have spread and to help determine if treatment is working and to look for possible signs of cancer coming back after treatment. And other tests like MRI, CT scan, PET scan, bone scan, pulmonary function test, bone marrow aspiration, and biopsy. And okay, then you can see this common lung cancer treatment. Surgery will be done, chemotherapy, targeted therapy, and immunotherapy. And different stages, if you see, you have first stage, tumor less than 3 cm, there is no metastasis, it has not spread. Then second stage, tumor less than 6 cm, single metastasis are observed. And then third stage, tumor more than 6 cm, metastasis in lymph nodes. Fourth stage is what? The tumor passed to other organs. So this is how different stages happen. And can lung cancer be prevented? This is very, very important. Yes, we know all these things are causes. Radon, workplace chemicals, air pollution, genetics, radiation therapy, and other lung diseases. So these are all non-smoking reasons. And the main reason is smoking reasons. So what accounts for majority causes of lung cancer? Adenocarcinoma, yes, non-small cell lung cancer accounts for almost 39% of all lung cancer cases. Squamous cell carcinoma is the second most common lung cancer, accounting for 20% of all the cases. And large cell carcinoma makes up less than 3%. Then what percentage of lung cancer is smoking responsible for? It is estimated that smoking is responsible for almost 90% of all lung cancer cases. And what is the most aggressive form of lung cancer? The small cell lung cancer, which makes up about 10% to 15% of all the lung cancers and is the most aggressive form of the disease. And what do we do? Prevention is better than cure. So we need to concentrate on eating healthy diet, avoid radon exposure, stay away from tobacco, exercise regularly, and limit exposure to cancer-causing agents in all ways. As I said, it need not be in a gaseous form. Whenever you buy any product in the store, see the ingredients, whether they are carcinogenic or what. Whether you eat or you apply, everything goes into your body. So be very, very cautious. Whatever the air you breathe, and the lotions you apply in your hair, the shampoo you use, the powder you use, the foundation, the eye makeup, everything. So you have to check the ingredients and see whether they have any carcinogenic percentage. Even the smallest percentage should be avoided. So this is very, very important. And we can also see how many the Globus can says like number of new cases in 2020 in both the sexes. Breast cancer is 13.5%, lip is 10.3%, cervix is 9.5%, 4%, and lung 5.5%. Though the percentage of cancer, lung cancer is less than breast cancer, the death rate is more for lung. And these are all for men and women. So here you can see the rates. You can concentrate on the lung that is in the fourth. It is ranking in the fourth, new cases. 72,510. So here you can see the death, 72,510, and the death is what? 66,279. You can now see how much death rate is there for lung cancer. So we have to really, really take extra care. And so that's it, and I've come to the end of my session. I hope you would have understood about this. May not be in-depth about the medical terms, but at least the causes, the precautionary steps which you have to take. And any questions or anything, you can reach me. I've given you my number and the YouTube channel. you can make use of these facilities. Thank you so much for the opportunity, and I hope you got some benefit out of this session. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It was a wonderful session, also an informative one. I'm sure the audience will learn a lot from this webinar, ma'am.
I'll be happy if they learn.
Yes, I'm sure they will.
Thank you so much.
So, participant, you can post your questions in the chat box, or you can unmute and tell. Unmute and ask, ma'am.
Yeah, I got a message. Thank you so much for the session. Thank you, Grace.
Girls, if you have any doubt, you can unmute.
You can also give feedback. Even if you don't have questions, you can give your feedback, whether you really understood what mistakes we have been doing, and whether we will be aware of all those. Because we are not conscious about until we get something, you know, we will not know what we are doing. And this session should make, if 100 or 200 people have attended, it should reach 20,000 people. You should spread the message. You should give awareness to others also. Thank you. Thank you so much, Akshaya, Fatima, Kalika, thank you so much. Swarna, thank you. Angel, thank you. Amrita, thank you so much. Harini, thank you. Kavipriya, thank you. Abhinaya, thank you. Anupriya, thank you. God bless you all. I hope, I wish I come in person and meet you all. Jayabharati, Samyukta, thank you so much. Priya, thank you. Niveda, thank you. Pooja, thank you. Sinduja, Pooja, thank you so much, Mariam. God bless you all. Stay with good health. People, ancestors used to say, health is wealth. But that is the true phrase which we should keep in mind.
So, out of thanks, on behalf of them, on behalf of the entire team, I would like to thank the speaker who honored this event with her inspirational thought. Thank you, ma'am. I would like to thank our beloved principal for granting us the permission, and also the faculty coordinators. Last but not least, I would like to thank the participants and the entire Rotaract team for making this event a grand success. Once again, I thank you and thank you for your presence. Thank you so much, ma'am, for your for this information section.
Thank you so much. God bless you all.
Thank you.
Can I leave?
Students are requested to...
Can I leave?
Thank you. Students are requested to fill the feedback form that's posted in the chat box.